In my presentations, I'm going to be looking at three chapters of Daniel, chapter 1, 2, and 3. And the way that I'm going to be approaching this chapter is I'm going to be dealing with these chapters at broad strokes. What I mean by that is I'm not going to take each chapter and dissect each and every detail in the chapter. But I'm going to deal with an overview of the chapter, and I will split them into slightly different. There are some things that I want to pick up in chapter 2 that I want us to study together. So I'm going to be looking at an overview of these chapters, but I'm going to spend a little bit more time looking at Daniel chapter 2. And even when you come to Daniel chapter 2, there are specific things that I'm looking at in Daniel chapter 2. So we're not going to be maybe discussing it the way we normally do at church and discuss the kingdoms as an example represented by that statue of Nebuchadnezzar. But there are things that are mentioned in that chapter, and I'm going to be picking up on those thoughts, and we're going to be seeing where those things are going to lead us. So this is how I'm going to be dealing with these chapters. And on the board here, I have a line that I've drawn, and this is kind of an overview of how I'm going to be approaching these chapters. So you can see here that I've drawn, this is our reform line. This is the reform line of the 144,000. And what I'm saying is, this first part of the reform line, I'm saying that Daniel chapter 2, Daniel chapter 1, sorry, not Daniel chapter 2, as typified, why is typifying this first angel, is dealing with this history. And from the history of this second, or this middle part of the line, the history of 9/11 to Midnight Cry, I'm saying that Daniel chapter 2 deals with this history. And this is the same history of the second angel's message. And so is Daniel chapter 3, dealing with this part of our history from the Midnight Cry to the Sunday Lord. This is the third angel's message. So the thing that I want to also look at, I want to bring to our attention, is this issue of decrees in this chapter. So when you get to Daniel chapter 2 and Daniel chapter 3, and what you want to end up doing is trying to see how this or what this means to us here at the end of the world, because you and I are in this history. So we're going to be speaking a little bit more about these decrees. So this is the basic structure of how I'm going to deal with these chapters. Maybe before I get to Daniel chapter 1, there could be some people here that are not familiar with some of these way marks, and I don't think I'm going to try and explain the reason why we have 1989 here, 9/11 here, Midnight Cry, and the Sunday Law. But I might explain some of those as I continue. If I come to a point and I see that I have to mention that point, I might have to do that. The reason why I don't want to get bogged down and try to explain all of this, I might not be able to finish my notes. So I hope that Brother Kant has
I shared with you my notes.
Are you going to share with them?
Okay. So once you have those notes, because there's a lot of things to read here, I'm not going to be reading each and everything in my notes. So if you have those notes, that would be good. Let's now turn to Daniel chapter 1. So when we are then in chapter 1, and you can see that I placed then in chapter 1 here from 1989. And 1989 is the time of the end. Okay? It's the time of the end for our generation. So when you go to then in chapter 11, verse 40. Talks about two events that are going to occur at the time of the end. And the first event is the king of the south warring against the king of the north. That was fulfilled in 1798 in the war of Napoleon with the papacy. Okay? And the papacy received its deadly wound at that time. That's 1798. And still in the same verse, which is at the time of the end, it says that the king of the north is going to retaliate against the king of the south. But when we come to our history, the king of the south is not atheistic France. It is a confederacy of nations that still have the same principles of atheistic France, and that was the USSR, the Soviet Union, which history tells us that his demise occurred, but he started to occur in 1989. And in fulfillment of the last part of that verse, verse 40 of Daniel 11. Okay, so that's why we have 1989 as the time of the end, as identified in that verse. But this phrase of the time of the end, it also means the end of a time prophecy. Okay? It also means the end of a time prophecy. But obviously in this history, we know that after 1844, time is no longer. So I'm not marking this 1989 as the end of a time prophecy. But it was a fulfillment of the event which is marked at the time of the end. Okay? But I'm also saying this, that at the time of the end is also the end of the time prophecy. For example, you can think about the 70 years of the captivity of the children of Israel in Babylon. Okay? So when you come to Cyrus being the man who is going to end the kingdom of Babylon, you have come to the time of the end. Okay? And many other examples can be drawn out, and I'm not going to go much into that. Just explain that simple logic. So when you look at Daniel chapter 1, let's read from verse 1. It says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem, and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar, to the house of his God. And he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. The king spake unto Aspenaz, the master of the eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel, and of the king's seed, and of the princes, and it goes on. So, when you get to this captivity of Jehoiakim, you've come to the end of the 490 years of probationary time. So when you look at the kings of Israel. The first king was Saul, okay, and Israel was split after Solomon. But from the time of Saul all the way to Jehoiakim is 490 years. And Ezra tells us that. Let's go to 2 Chronicles.
Chapter
36, I think that's what I'm looking at. Where is this going to explain 70 years?
Verse 21.
Verse 21, yeah, that's verse 21. Okay. So we pick up from verse 20. And here it says this. And them that escaped from the sword carried he away to Babylon, so his name kind of, where they were servants to him and his sons until the reign of the kingdom of Persia, to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, until the land had enjoyed her Sabbath, for as long as she lay desolate, she kept Sabbath, to fulfill a 70 years. So we can understand that when the children of Israel were 70 years in Babylonian captivity, according to this, the land which is now desolate, here is Jerusalem, it was getting back its Sabbath. So if you go to the book of Leviticus, God had commanded the children of Israel that as soon as they enter into the promised land, the statute was you were supposed to plow the land for 6 years, and the 7th year, the land was supposed to rest. But Israel never observed that statute. They didn't keep that law. The land didn't rest in that time until you come to Jehoiakim, when they were taken captive. And according to, and if you look at 70 years, those are 70 Sabbaths of the land. And if you are going to have a Sabbath of the land to rest every 7 years, then for you to make 70 years of the rest of the land, that you have to go through a total of 490 years. Okay? So can we fold that? We can fold that. Maybe you can fold that.
Maybe others are not fold.
Maybe others are not fold. I was looking at the number of years. So it's simple math. The land was supposed to rest every seventh year, and they're in captivity for 70 years. And these 70 years are the years that they didn't allow the land to rest. Okay? And if the land couldn't rest in a total of 70 years, for you to find out how many years where they were coming from, how many years did they have to go through and skip the Sabbath, you just multiply it by 7 because it was every 7th year. And this gives you a total of 490. Okay, so that's a simple math. With that. Now, when you come to this captivity of Jehoiakim, they've come to, if you have, this is Saul, and you're going to have Jehoiakim here. And this one is saying that this is 490 years when they didn't allow the land to rest, and they're going to be 70 years in captivity. So these 70 years answering back to this 490 years. So when you come to the captivity, this is the captivity of Jehoiakim's captivity. You have come to the end of this, and the number, the 490 years is a probationary time. Okay? Is a probationary time. And when was it Peter who asked Christ how many times should he forgive his brother? He said seven times, and what did Christ say?
70 times 7.
Okay, so Christ is referring back to he's wanting them to see this 490 years. You have the 490 with the 70 what? 70 weeks, is it? In Daniel 9:24. So you have 72. 72 weeks is how many years?
490.
It's 490. So you have this 490, what I'm saying is probationary time. So when you come to Jehoiakim, you have come to the end of this probationary time. Okay? You've come to the end of this probationary time. So if you are looking at this probationary time, you would say that you've come to the end. You can mark this as the time of the end, depending on the point that you are trying to. Depending on the point that you are trying to make. So, this was my logic of praising Daniel chapter 1 here. I'm saying that. You have the 490 here of probationary time, which is the 490 years of rebellion, okay, which is consistent. When you look at other reform lines, you always have a period of darkness before you come to the time of the end. And that period of darkness, in essence, it is the time of rebellion for God's people. Okay? God's people are in apostasy or they're in rebellion. So it's the same thing that takes place for this history. And the other thing as well, those that have been, those that have studied the reform lines, we understand that 1989, at the time of the end, let me just say the time of the end. The time of the end with all the reform lines. When you come to the time of the end, God is going to start testing his people. And when he tests his people, he takes them, there's different groups that he deals with, one after another. And the first group that he deals with when we come to 1989 is the leaders. Leaders are always tested first. So the time of the end, the leaders are being tested. And if you look at this captivity of Jehoiakim, the people that are taken first is the king and the princes. Okay? The king and the princes are taken with this first captivity of Judah. And the king is taken with the princes. And I'm saying that this marks, or this is consistent with the fact that when you come to the time of the end, the people that are dealt with first are the leaders. And obviously the king and the princes, they were the leaders of God's people. Okay, so that's my logic of placing this here, locating it there. So let's now look at Daniel, because our interest here is in the activities of Daniel and how he's going to interact with the Babylonians. And this is a verse that is common to us, or at least is well known to us, if we're going to deal, or whenever we deal with the health message, which is the right arm of the Pharisee's message. This verse is a verse that we usually read. and for a good reason. Verse 8 of Daniel, chapter 1. So here, as soon as Daniel gets into Babylon, he's going to be confronted with the issue of diet. Okay? And I want to spend a little bit of time talking about diet. And it boasts its little application and its prophetic dimension. Okay? What is going to be put before Daniel? The portion of the king's meat, right? So something is going to be put before Daniel, and is the portion of the king's meat. So the first test here is going to be on diet. What are you going to eat? Okay? But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Okay. So Daniel understands that there's meat and drink which defiles and which God forbids, and this meat and drink which is allowed, which is lawful. And as we read this, we can see here that obviously Nebuchadnezzar wanted to make Daniel Babylonian. He didn't change Daniel's name. Daniel's friends, they got that name changed into the name of the gods of the Babylonians. Okay, so what Nebuchadnezzar is trying to do, he's trying to change the whole mindset of Daniel, his conception, his view of things. Okay, he wants to change his whole culture of Daniel. But Daniel is not going to bend and go along with the king. And he says here that he purposed in his heart. He purposed in his heart. And something that Christians fail to understand most of the times, and sometimes us, we think that standing for truth is some kind of miracle that God does in our behalf. Maybe there is that part. But the issue is, we need to purpose in our hearts. If you go to books like Christian Temperance and Bible Hygiene and Mind, Character, and Personality, even the book Education, and how Sister White talks about the will that God has given man, the will. It says it's a kingly power. Okay? The kingly power of the soul is the will. And that's the only thing that can, if you can ask, why is a man saved? Or why is he lost? The issue is, it's always with his will. Okay? The only thing that can prevent God from saving man is that man's will. That's the only thing. With all, and God is powerful, you understand that God is almighty. But God is love also. And love demands that God does not force himself. Okay? God doesn't compel anyone, doesn't coerce anyone to accept him. The issue is with the will. Okay, so when Daniel here purposes in his heart, he has trained his will. And if you go and read even the book Sanctified Life, you'll see that this has been Daniel's practice throughout all his life. And he purposed his heart not with this big issue in Babylon, but in the common affairs of life, the simple things throughout his boyhood and when he was growing up. So when Christ says, If you are not faithful in the little things, you are not going to be faithful in much. You need to spend some time thinking about that and see what it means. Let me read a quotation here in Testimonies to Ministers 114 in paragraph 1. And let's hear what Sister White is going to connect that with the study of the prophetic way. Okay, so if you and I are going to understand Daniel, the issue of diet is brought to view. We have the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ, which is the spirit of prophecy. Priceless gems are to be found in the Word of God. Those who search this way should keep the mind clear. Never should they indulge perverted appetite in eating or in drinking. If they do this, if they do what? If they are going to indulge perverted appetite, and here Sister White is talking about the food that we eat. If they are going to indulge perverted appetite, why is it perverted? What does this word mean, perverted? If something, perversion, what does that mean?
Natural.
It's a natural.
It's corrupted.
It's what?
Corrupted.
Yeah, it's corrupted. Okay, so it's a good thing, but it's been taken out of the way, or it's been removed from serving the purpose that was intended to serve. Okay, or someone has added more to that. Okay, has either you have reduced it so that it doesn't have its force, or you have increased it beyond the limits that it was given. Okay, for example, we're supposed to eat food so that our bellies we're satisfied. But if I'm going to eat the whole pot, I've perverted eating. Can you see that? Okay, it becomes dangerous now to me. So something that is good becomes what? Dangerous. So perverted appetite, if they indulge this, if they do this, the brain will be confused. Okay. And where is the mind housed? It's housed in the brain. The brain houses the mind. Okay? And this is where your willpower is. So, if you are confused by eating this, by having this perverted appetite, Sister White says, they will be unable to bear the strain of digging deep to find out the meaning of those things which relate to the closing scenes of this earth's history. Okay? And do we need to understand the things that relate to the closing scenes of this history? Well, definitely, we need to understand those. And are we supposed to dig deeper into the study of the Word of God? Of course. Of course. Do you know that it's a requirement to dig deeper into the study of gospel? It's a requirement, and if you cannot do that, you're not going to be saved. How is a Seventh Adventist going to be saved in comparison to a non-Adventist Christian? A lot is required from who? From an Adventist. Okay, so for example, a non-Adventist can just believe in Jesus. Okay? And at the end of the world, they just have to believe that the Sabbath is the law of God and must be kept. Is that what you and I just need? Do we just need to know that the Sabbath is a commandment of the Lord and has to be kept? No. No, you and I are required to learn a lot more than that. We're required to understand that the history of the Millerites is going to repeat here to the very letter. We need to understand that God is going to use Islam, for example, to bring the one world government. We need to understand that this administration of the USA is the last one. We need to understand all of these things. We need to understand that we're entering now when the image of the beast is being set up. And according to Sister White, that is going to be our greatest test. Okay, so that's going to be a great test to the people of God. And this is a great test to you. You need to know that you are being tested. You're going to pass a test if you didn't know that you are being tested. You can't do that. At school, if the teacher surprises you with a test, there's hardly anyone who passes that test. So we need to think about that also. This is Christian Temperance and Bible Hygiene, page 11, paragraph 1. The prevailing sin, the indulgence of perverted appetite, inflamed the passions of men in the days of Noah and led to widespread corruption. Thus Christ gave a prophecy about the end of the world, where he says, just as how it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days when the Son of Man should appear. So Christ tells us that the history of Noah is going to repeat to the letter. In that history, God says his spirit is not going to strive with man. Okay? God withdrew his spirit from the antediluvians. And we are told here that the prevailing sin in that history was this sin of perverted appetite. Violence and sin reached to heaven. The moral pollution was finally swept from the earth by means of the flood. And we understand that this flood is represented. This is the overflowing sketch brought to view in Isaiah 28. This is the Sunday law flood. The same sins of gluttony and drunkenness benumbed the moral sensibilities of the inhabitants of Sodom, so that crime seemed to be the delight of men and women of that wicked city. So Christ gives a prophecy about Sodom as well. And the same sin that is brought to view, the same sin is being brought to view here of perverted appetite. And in Acts of the Apostles, page 317, paragraph 1, it says this, Acts of the Apostles 317, paragraph 1. The apostles' words of warning to the Corinthian church are applicable to all time and are specially adapted to our day. By idolatry, he meant not only the worship of idols, but self-saving, love of ease, the gratification of appetite and passion, a mere profession of faith in Christ, a boastful knowledge of the truth, which you and I are in danger of in this movement. A boastful knowledge of the truth does not make a man a Christian. Okay? A religion that seeks only to gratify the eye, the ear, maybe come for these meetings to gratify the eye and the ear and the taste, or that sanctions self-indulgence, is not the religion of Christ. In referring, and Paul is going to talk about temperance, and he's going to give an imagery of an athlete or athletes are competing for a prize. And he continues to say, in referring to this race as a figure of the Christian warfare, Paul emphasized the preparation necessary for the success of the contestants in the race, the preliminary discipline, the abstemious diet, the necessity for temperance. Every man that strives for the mastery, he declared, is temperate in all things. The runners must put aside indulgence that would tend to weaken the physical powers, and by severe and continuous discipline, train their muscles to strength and endurance, that when the day of contest should arrive, they might put to the heaviest tax upon their powers. How much more important that the Christian, whose eternal interests are at stake, bring appetite and passion under subjection to reason and the will of God. Never must he allow his attention to be diverted by amusements, luxuries, or ease. All his habits and passions must be brought under the strictest discipline. Reason, enlightened by the teachings of God's word and guided by his spirit, must hold the reins of control. So, in this figure of athletes, Paul is demonstrating here the Christian warfare. And he says that athletes who train themselves and they put themselves under serious discipline, okay, and they're not going to eat whatever they want and however they want. They're going to be selective in what they are going to eat. Okay? And the reason why they are doing this is so that when the day of contest should come, and is the day of contest coming? Of course. The day of contest is coming. And when that day should come, these muscles were going to be put under the heaviest tax. Okay? Let's start to make or draw out prophetic symbolism in that language. Daniel refuses to eat the king's meat, and I'm saying that the king's meat here and the wine is a symbol of papal doctrines. Okay? The meat of Nebuchadnezzar and his wine is a symbol of papal doctrines. It can be easy for us to see that Nebuchadnezzar is a symbol of the papacy, because the papacy is the king of the north, is the king of Babylon. The papacy is Babylon. Okay? So, in Christian Temperance and Bible Hygiene, page 26 in paragraph 2, Sister White is commenting on this, and said the food appointed them would include meats pronounced unlawful by the law of Moses. Okay? So the foods that Daniel referred to and said that they were, or that they would defile him, are the foods that they pronounced unclean here by the law of Moses. Okay? They pronounced unclean by the law, and we'll speak more on that. But I want us to go to Revelation 2 and verse 14. And we are reading verse 20 as well. And this is the message to the church of Pergamos. Okay, this is when the papacy is hijacking the church. And I want you to see that the issue of needs that are forbidden by the law of Moses are brought to view in the same passage. If you look at verse 14, it says, but I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit what? Fornication. Okay? So two things. They are eating things that are sacrificed unto idols, and these are the meats that are pronounced unclean by the law of Moses. And this meat that they eat is connected to fornication. It's connected to fornication. Eating this meat of the idols and are committing fornication. And verse 20 says, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee. And is this to Thyatira now? Yeah, this is message to Thyatira. This is when the papacy now is sitting upon the throne of the earth. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which is the papal church, who calleth herself a prophetess, to do what? to teach and to seduce my servants to what? Commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. Okay, so in verse 14 in message to the church of Pergamos, there's that reference of people eating meats sacrificed unto idols and they're committing fornication. And here, the woman Jezebel is presiding over this church, and there's an issue of teachings that are going around, and the servants of God are being seduced and are led to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed to idols. And the point that I mentioned earlier before, saying that when I look at this meat and the wine, the prophetic symbolism of that is this papal doctrines. Okay, when you come to this history, so we are moving from the meat being the literal diet that you and I are still required to eat right. We need to be sure that we understand properly the health message and how it's connected with our understanding of the prophetic truth. And I've transitioned from that now to say that there's a prophetic dimension to that meat. And I'm saying that this meat that Daniel, this meat and wine that Daniel refused to eat, is a symbol of papal doctrines. And when we come to this history, is God going to offer his people meat to eat? Of course. And this verse was read this morning by one of the brothers. If you go to Isaiah 28, let's go there and I'll come back to read a passage from the notes. Let's go to Isaiah 28. Whenever we come to the time of the end, according to Daniel chapter 12 in verse 4, when you come to the time of the end, there's going to be an increase of knowledge. And this increase of knowledge is a revelation of a prophetic message that was sealed before that time. And God is going to open up that truth to that generation. And it's going to be an unfolding of that truth till you come to the end of that reform line. So, this is the time of the end. Okay? And when Isaiah 28, and this verse was read this morning, verse 9, whom shall he teach knowledge? So with every reform line, whenever you come to the time of the end, there is an increase of knowledge. And when God says, whom shall he teach knowledge? That verse is being asked here because it is in his history that God is going to open up the prophetic way, and we'll talk about what that is in this history. There's a special message that God is going to open up in this history that is going to be increasing, and this is an escalation of increase of that knowledge. And it deals with all of this history. Whatever is revealed here, it deals with all of this history. And this is what God is doing at this point. This is where this question is asked. Whom shall he teach knowledge? And whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Okay. If you go back to verse 1, when God is asking this question here in 1989, and he's asking the leaders, because remember the leaders are tested first, as I mentioned, the prince, the king and the princes were taken first. Verse 1 of chapter 20 says, woe to the crown of pride, to the drunkards of Ephraim, whose glorious beauty is a fading flower, which are on the head of the fat valleys of them that are overcome with wine. Okay, so when this question is asked, there's a group of people here that are identified as the crowd, the drunkards of Ephraim, and are overcome with wine. This is something different to what Daniel is doing. Daniel is purposing in his heart not to define himself with the wine of the king. He doesn't want to be drunk with wine. He's not identified as a drunkard. But when God is going to ask this question, there's a group of people here that are noted as the drunkards of Ephraim. And these drunkards of Ephraim are the leaders of God's people. They're identified in this chapter as the leaders of God's people. But God, still in His mercy, wanted them to be sober. Okay? They've been imbibing these Babylonian doctrines during this time. Remember, this is a time of darkness. This is a time of rebellion. Okay? They've been imbibing this wine all along. And God in His mercy comes to them and He wants them to be sober. He wants to bring this increase of knowledge to them so that they can be wise unto salvation. But they're not going to do that. So if you go back to on the same chapter, what is that, or how is God going to bring that increase of knowledge? My brother read it this morning. It's in verse 10. Is this line upon line method. So he's going to bring them a message, and he's going to even identify the manner in which they're supposed to eat that message. He's going to set food before them, and he's going to even show them or teach them how they're supposed to eat it. But in the same chapter, in Isaiah 28, what is the response of these people, which are leaders, who are identified as the drunkards of Ephraim? They're saying what? They don't want the refreshing, do they? In verse 12, to whom he said, this is the rest. Okay, this line upon line, to these people, God says, this is the rest, wherein you may cause the weary to rest. And this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear. Okay? They would not do what?
Yeah.
They would not hear. So, the increase of knowledge that God brings in this history, it's the message of Daniel 11, 40 to 45. In the Bible, go to Ezekiel chapter 3, Jeremiah 50, Revelation chapter 10. God identifies a message, and this message is written in a scroll. Okay? And the prophets of God, symbolizing His church, are commanded to eat that scroll or that book. Okay? And that book to them is the food that they're supposed to eat. And I'm saying that the food that God is offering His people in this history, and because the leaders are tested first, they are the ones that are called to partake of this food, to not eat of the king of the portion of king's meat, but to eat the food that God is offering them. It is the message that comes from this this chapter of Daniel, and the verses that are the last verse of that chapter, verses 40 to 45. And what Daniel 40 to 45 is, It identifies the working of the man of sin in this history, the resurrection of the papacy and its last word. That's what Daniel 11:40-45 is all about. It's the resurrection of the man of sin, the resurrection of the papacy, and its word of bringing in the Sunday law, which is going to bring us to the close of the great controversy ever since it began with Lucifer in heaven. Okay? So we need to understand the message contained in this verse of Daniel 11 so that God's people can be warned and there can be a preparation in this history. It is in this history that God is going to enter into a covenant or renew his covenant. The covenant of Abraham is going to be renewed here with his people, which are going to constitute the church triumphant. So it is the method. I want to identify two things. I'm saying this is the food, or this is the meat. Okay? And I've said that first we have the what? Paul says first the natural and then the
spiritual.
The spiritual. And we have read in testimonies to ministers that if you are going to understand then in Revelation, what should you eat? Should you have perverted appetite? No. You shouldn't. And that's talking about the little food that we eat. But also at a prophetic level or at a spiritual level, we should eat the right food. We should be selective in what we are going to eat. I've just compared the king's meat and his wine to papal doctrines, and I've taken you to the history of the church of Pergamos and that of Thyatira, and it talks about the meat that were sacrificed to idols. Okay? And those people that were eating that kind of meat were led into one to commit what? Fornication. So in this history, when God is going to open up this the message contained in Daniel 45, he's even giving us the way we're supposed to eat that message. Okay? The way we're supposed to eat this message, line upon line. And my brother explained this morning what that encompasses. This is not just proof texting. We are instructed to go and look at past histories and compare them. Okay? We're supposed to go back and draw out these histories and compare them and see how each history was prefigured by the other, so that we can be able to know what's taking place here at the end of the world. And this line upon line the rules for it are Miller's rules. So not only are you supposed to eat this little book, which is the correct diet that you and I should eat and be selective, you're just supposed to eat everything that is dished out to us here in Adventism. But there's a method in which you are supposed to eat it. You are supposed to eat this food line upon line. And the correct way of using line upon line is William Miller's 14 rules. Alright? So, in the next presentation, we'll touch a little bit more about Miller's rules and connect it with Daniel, because Daniel went on a 10 days test, and at the end, how was Daniel and his friends? They looked fatter and fairer than those that were not eating the right food And at the end of the 3 years, when they brought before Nebuchadnezzar, they found to be 10 times wiser. And so we're going to touch on those aspects and try to bring them here on this line. And then we're going to go into Daniel chapter 2. We're going to spend a lot of time in Daniel chapter 2, really. I think that's where my whole study is, in Daniel chapter 2. So, I don't know if people are going to follow what I try to explain. Before we close, are there any questions? Okay, good question.
Just a request.
Any question?
Yeah, well, some of the other brethren, when they're doing giving the quotes, just jot them on the side. Because, you know, while we're listening to what you're saying, we're also drawing some of the stuff. Sometimes I need it
for me. That is already solved. You just need to get the notes on this part.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. So make sure you get the notes from the line. So let's...